Hey folks, big day for Kingdom Hearts happenings in case you somehow missed it. Long story short, a closed 20th anniversary event was held in Japan that ran on April 10th from about 1 a.m. to 7 a.m. Eastern Time, and at the end of that event, a big, nearly 8-minute trailer was dropped concerning the future of the series. The trailer is essentially split into three parts, with the first part focused on the Dark Road finale, the second part on a new mobile game called Kingdom Hearts Missing Link, and third, the obvious headliner, an announcement for Kingdom Hearts 4. No subtitle, no crazy name, just KHIV, or KIV as everyone's calling it. The timeline we have, by the way, is an August release for the Dark Road finale and a closed beta for Missing Link sometime this year. KH4, unsurprisingly and understandably, is nothing beyond in development for now. Or rather, magic in the making to avoid being memed on. The purpose of this video is to serve as a vehicle to deliver my thoughts in a more structured way slash deep dive on the footage we receive. If you want my initial reaction to the KH4 stuff in particular, that also exists on my channel. Bear in mind that this isn't intended to be a perfect dissection of everything, and I'm likely gonna get some stuff wrong, but I'm really excited to share my thoughts on everything we've seen so far. So let's start digging into this. Full disclosure, I am not up to date on, nor am I super invested in the Dark Road stuff, so I'm gonna just give my more surface level thoughts on things as we go through this part. It kicks off with Old Master Xehanort in Dwarf Woodlands speaking to the Magic Mirror, and we definitely have a tiny bit of history there going back to Birth by Sleep when Terra sort of strong-arms the Evil Queen into letting him ask about the whereabouts of Master Xehanort, which the Mirror is able to answer. I would assume that this takes place prior to BBS unless Xehanort is coming back to, like, break the Mirror's face for snitching. I mean, he actually wanted Terra to find him so he could manipulate him, so maybe they were just in cahoots all along. We then move along to Skylad Kylum as it's seen in Dark Road with young Xehanort, Ericus, and their memorable friends with names. Baldur, Bragi, Hermud, Hermod, Erd, and Ver. I swear this isn't the first time I've seen these names, but they never get any easier to take. TLDPOWDR, that's too long, didn't play or watch Dark Road, they're all students of Master Odin in the same way that Terra, Aqua, and Ven are to Ericus many years later. Xehanort comments that he's not sure why he wants to become a Keyblade Master, and we cut to him and Ericus getting ready to square off and not in a friendly sparring match way. This would obviously not be the last time they would raise their weapons at each other. We then have Xehanort, Ericus, and Ver being attacked by the Magic Mirror, which gives some context to that earlier scene since it seemed like Uldnor and the Mirror had already met. Then we cut to what's looking like the Cave of Wonders treasure room, with Xehanort and Ericus now joined by Erd before being surrounded by Volcanic Lord and Blizzard Lord, who first appeared in Cage 2 Agrabah, and I'm guessing these are like their grandparents. Then we cut to the underworld, with Ericus and Xehanort now joined by Bragi and Hermud, with the latter pair staying behind to fight Cerberus, while Ericus and Xehanort run away holding hands. This event 75 years ago inspired the 2002 Yokoshimamura track, Hand in Hand. We're then dropped in some area set in Enchanted Dominion, where the still-unnamed upperclassmen discuss an evil fairy, obviously referring to Maleficent, questioning why she would curse Princess Aurora, followed by a bit of them fighting Maleficent in her dragon form. Bear in mind that when we're dealing with especially the Disney stuff in the mobile games, a lot of it is based on the Book of Prophecies, so it's hard to say how much of this is truly relevant or impactful on present-day events. Back in Skala, Master Odin reminds an upperclassman of his task, which is studying darkness, after he seems to refer to Kingdom Hearts as forbidden. Cutting back to Agrabah, we have that same upperclassman holding the magic lamp in an area reminiscent of where Aladdin first finds it in the movie, and he appears to be instructing Xehanort's group to take it and find the light. Sorry that some of these are literally just recaps of what we're seeing, but I'm trying to be thorough. Next, interestingly, we have an unknown area that seems to be shrouded in darkness, and also literally populated by capital D darkness, which features heavily in Union Cross and can be thought of as the 13 quote-unquote original darknesses. More obviously, you can see Ericus and Xehanort in their armor, both collapsed, before Odin shows up and comments, "So only you remain," possibly implying the demise or disappearance of the other classmates. I would assume that this would be very late game stuff in the Dark Road finale, even the colors here give me like final hour of Union Cross vibes. This is followed up by what may or may not be the actual next thing that Xehanort sees, the Master of Masters in a cutesy what you doin' pose waiting for him to wake up. You can tell this black coat is him just from the first frame, driven home by the casual and chipper morning. I would assume that this is the first time Xehanort meets the Master, and we'd get some follow-up on this in the early hours of Cage 3 Remind, where they discuss young Xehanort's journey. And then we pop back into Skylad Kylum, because what would a pre-release hype cycle even look like without Ericus and Xehanort playing their chess game? Ericus comments that he wants to stay true to the light, which we know in hindsight to be done blindingly so all the way into his old age. Afterwards, we go back to that previous tense fight scene, with Xehanort commenting that Kingdom Hearts is the only way, potentially referring to his ultimate plan to remake the capital W world with him as the Arbiter, the plan that Sora thwarts in Cage 3. The two friends clash keys and the logo drops. We then get a brief post-logo clip of young Xehanort laying flowers at a grave, which, for all we know, could be anyone's grave at anyone's time. I would bet on it being Odin's grave sometime after he meets the Master of Masters, as it seems like some sort of calamity strikes that may have wiped out slash transformed slash time-traveled the entire class. That's just my gut reaction as someone who has, again, barely dabbled into the Dark Road stuff. The Missing Link part of the trailer kicks off with the text "an unwritten era," which I think already lends itself to a lot of speculation. Given how I just mentioned that so much UX and DR stuff ties into the Book of Prophecies, the prospect of an era being unwritten and unforetold, or even just uncertain, is pretty exciting. Given that we know a lot of this is set in the newer, darker Skalad Kylum, you would have to assume that it's post-Union Cross, but still long before BBS. Set to a stompy and clappy and choir-y new rendition of Dearly Beloved, we're given a few quick cuts from various games, both mobile and non, and are then reminded that everything is connected, which especially serves to accent the clips that immediately precede it. Master Xehanort in both young and old forms on Destiny Islands, Riku in the Secret Place, and Hooded Ansem SOD, who we know to have visited both of them. We're then taken to Skalad Kylum, looking more similar to how it appears in the Union Cross finale than in KH3. We see a hooded figure who you can most safely assume to be Lushu, as he's holding no name. We're then shown a new character who I would bet is only named generically and is likely a base default avatar for a player character dressed in a white sort of captain or admiral getup. The voiceover refers to Skala as a city of light, darkness, dreams, distortion, the remembered, and the forgotten. There is a lot to think about there, considering Skala looks so different from how we first came to know it. It's not really known how much of its true history as Daybreak Town has been preserved and how exactly it managed to survive in this state. There is, as you can see, a statue of Ephemer that the new character approaches, who sort of embodies the remembered half of things, but who knows exactly how much of what we came to know in Union Cross can fall under that forgotten category. And you obviously need to keep an eye on this being described as a place of dreams and distortion. We've only been leaning more and more into concepts involving sleep and dreams as the series has progressed. Obviously, we were introduced to a lot of it in Dream Drop Distance, but it's continued to tie into KH3 and Union Cross era stuff, whether it's the connections between the Key Kids and Dream Eaters, or the Final World being an area between sleep and death. The boy in the white coat seems to be receiving information from someone through an earpiece, probably Hiro telling him that he's headed off course. White Coat then produces a new red and black keyblade, which we might assume to be the default keychain in Missing Link. We're then given some in-game footage, and immediately I'm struck with memories of Pokemon Go, as it looks like some sort of geolocation features are at play here. We see White Coat running up a building, so I would recommend you start hitting the gym again. Before even getting into the gameplay slash rage toward the potential for gacha mechanics, the fact that this game could have even the slightest thing to do with real-life geography is incredibly eyebrow-raising considering the unreality of it all and the more realistic angle things seem to be shifting towards. Like, if we have a KH game that's played by moving around in the real world, or even just the game pulling from the real world, those connections and themes are only further strengthened. I think there's high potential for things to get especially, and maybe even distressingly, meta with this upcoming arc. In the footage behind the vertical video, we can see a map with pin icons and heartless models. I would assume running into one of these heartless models on the so-called overworld would throw you into one of those circular combat arenas seen later on. Talking about it with some friends, I don't really get the impression that this is just Pokemon Go but fighting heartless instead of catching Pokemon. In fact, we're not really under the impression that it necessitates a lot of IRL movement. What seems more plausible is a sort of Scala-themed map being generated depending on your actual location, which is obviously different depending on where you are. Maybe you'd even be able to spawn in wherever you want on Earth, or at least anywhere with map data, which would keep the experience fresh and make it possible to play with friends, since we see multiple player characters running around in battle. That is to say, I don't actually think there's a lot of physical movement required, since it seems like you just control the character directly through swiping and poking, so you can probably keep that gym membership cancelled. Brief breakdown of some gameplay elements here, we see a collection of different Heartless show up in battle, all of which appear in KH3. Large bodies, shadows, parasol beauties, bizarre archers, and what looks to be a sort of raid or boss encounter with a dark side. We only see multiple players during this dark side portion, so multiplayer gameplay may or may not be limited to these sorts of raid encounters, but no knowing for sure. Speaking of these other players, I think we can safely assume there'll be a considerable degree of customization with your player model, and wouldn't be surprised if additional stuff can be unlocked and or bot, but there are some pretty cool looking outfits like this red and black getup alongside some others that are briefly seen in the dark side part. As for the gameplay outside of navigation, it does seem like a spiritual successor to Union Cross, swapping out 2D medals for 3D trophies. We can't see any UI, but it looks like this is real-time stuff here, and fighting involves selecting these trophies or statues. This does, however, lend to the idea that a lot of this stuff will still be contextualized, or rather not contextualized, through Book of Prophecy hand-waving stuff, or at least something adjacent to that idea. Wielding trophies of characters who don't exist yet in the timeline in settings that might not make sense for this new batch of Key Kids to be exploring, hard to say how much of this is really truly happening. Speaking of those worlds, I am assuming the overworld would always be styled after Skala, but you can still end up fighting battles in non-Skala worlds. No idea how that's going to be explained if you're running down Skala and engage a Heartless in combat and then find yourself in Kingdom of COVID. could, again, just be some sort of book of prophecy, his heart's a portal, dreamy, sleepy thing to give us some environment variety. We see some familiar places here, the aforementioned KOC, and a sort of deep pool in a 0.2 Forest of Thorns type of area where this dark side battle takes place. But in the middle is this area that I'm not really sure what to think of. I think after consideration, I lean toward it being just a different part of Skala, but I was also getting both Twilight Town and Monstropolis vibes from the brief clip we see here. Parts of it seem almost factory-esque or like sort of industrial, and given that I'm assuming the new red and black Keyblade is the default, I'm most comfortable tying that to Skala, and it seems to have a gear or cog on the tip which fits right in with this sort of environment. So maybe this is just like a different district or underground area of the city. Back to the battling stuff, it potentially seems like not every attack is tied to a trophy, since it looks like the player is doing some basic combos with no character statue to be seen. The female character in green also appears to be shooting a sort of basic non-elemental magic projectile without a trophy, so it's possible you have basic physical and magical options and potentially stats for both. But special attacks definitely seem to necessitate selecting a trophy. So far, we can see trophies featuring Sora, Donald, Terra, Mickey, Aqua, another Sora, this one in an action pose, Goofy, Riku, and Cloud, which is definitely the odd one out, but a welcome addition. They show it twice in a row in case you blinked. Given that we have a Sora trophy in both neutral and action poses, it's possible that there are just separate trophies depicting the same character in different stances, or that there's a sort of level-up feature that powers up the strength or style of attack alongside how the character looks or how they're posed. Those attacks we saw, by the way, include what looks like Aroga, Waterga, I think Stun Impact, Faraga, Blazaga, Thundaga, I think something reminiscent of Geo Impact or a new rock or ground-based prefix line of spells, and Triple Faraga. The Cloud Trophy seems to activate some sort of advanced Keyblade combo move, though I'm not sure if it's pulling from something directly. Is that Omni Slash? I don't remember what Omni Slash looks like. Once all the gameplay stuff is over, we get another cutscene, which I'm just assuming will be in the actual game. I know that's maybe weird or stupid to say or question, but I can already feel how hot and loud my shitty outdated iPhone is getting. But we get 3D Brain, which if you're unfamiliar is a Union Cross character, one of the new Union leaders after the Foretellers. Union Cross ended with him waking up and being greeted by Sigurd in Skull Ad Kylum. Now, I have no idea who's talking here, forgive my unfamiliarity with the Japanese voice actors, but I would assume this is either Lushu, since the voiceover starts when he's on screen, or at least I assume it's Lushu, Brain, or Sigurd. The latter two have never been voiced before, so if it's a new voice, it's likely one of them. The voice says, "The night you awoke in this world," which could either be Sigurd referring to Brain, or potentially Brain referring to the player character. If you're reading it super literally, Brain doesn't seem to wake up in the new Skala at night in the Union Cross ending, but this could just refer to the night on the same day that Brain arrived. Again, this whole monologue could be directed to the player character, I'm not really sure. And then title drop and announcement of the closed beta. Obviously, I'm never thrilled when we're dealing with like another mobile game that may or may not have super important plot elements buried within it, doubly so if it's a gacha game, but listen, I'm still gonna check it out, so, you know. Okay, finally, we're at the real shit. I guess we can declaratively refer to Phase 2 of the series as the Lost Master Arc in the same way that the first phase was the Dark Seeker Saga. We open up in an interior section in Quadratum with a voiceover, I would assume speaking to Sora, directly or indirectly, or potentially any non-Quadratum native who's ended up here. Again, not sure who's speaking, so let me know if you have the Japanese voice actor matched up. Could be someone entirely new, I'm not sure. Outdoors and in the sky, some dark particles are forming which are later going to make up the gnarliest motherfucker of a Heartless since the Dark Thorn. After some heart and soul vague posting, we get the forest. Listen, I don't know what to make of the forest. I'm seeing a lot of people saying it's Endor from Star Wars. There's this big robot foot in the top right here. I've never been a pro or anti-Star Wars guy. I think they can make it work just like they've made nearly everything else work in the series. I know some people are against it because it wasn't originally Disney, but I really don't care. It wasn't my initial reaction. I was first reminded of the Secret Forest from KH3, but this does seem like it's probably something separate. It'd be weird to just plop a covert Star Wars thing in the middle of all of this. Like, I think there's actually a lot in favor of Star Wars and other live-action properties appearing in KH4, but it really is just randomly thrown into the Quadratum stuff. But, I mean, it could be a kind of neat and secretive way to tease an upcoming world. I don't know. After a brief look at the Skala chessboard, we see Sora waking up on a couch, and if you weren't even sure if that was Sora when you first saw him, you're not alone. He looks markedly different, specifically his hair, which is like almost wholly unspiked, maybe to reflect the more realistic world he's found himself in. I mean, there's like hair gel and product in the real world, but people aren't really waking up naturally spiky. His outfit is also different, harkening back to this sort of casual school fit in this art here. If this is all taking place after his battle with Yozora, the result of which is still, like, up in the air, though I lean towards losing being canon, I guess someone found him and, like, changed him into these new clothes. They forgot to put shoes on him, though, regrettably. But I kind of legitimately think they did this because of actual Japanese etiquette. Quadratum is shown to be so similar to our world, especially Shibuya, so of course Sora wouldn't rudely be wearing shoes indoors. I mean, he's on the naughty list, but fuck. For the record, there are so many possibilities when it comes to doppelganger, dreamlike shenanigans that this guy might not even be 100% Sora. I'm not going too far into theory crafting territory here, that's not really my market, but given how strange the Azora stuff is in Remind, how he says this isn't how I really look, and how he attacks Sora but he is also trying to save him, it can mean pretty much anything for this new, incredibly different looking Sora. It should also be noted that Sora does not actually speak, though he does have battle grunts in the gameplay portion, so take from that what you will. Anyway, and we'll just go with Sora for now, he wakes up in what looks like an apartment or hotel room of some kind and is greeted by Strelitzia, who fucking died like a million years ago in Union Cross, and that was like her whole thing. If you're unfamiliar, she was a member of the Dandelions and is the sister of Lorium, Marluxia's somebody, and friends with Elraina, Larxene's somebody. She had an unclean and mysterious death at the hands of Capital D Darkness, and she somehow ended up in Quadratum. Her outfit is also different and simpler than her Union Cross appearance, for whatever that's worth. Now, early post-KH3 but pre-Remind theories often had Strelitzia and the Nameless Star in the final world as one and the same, but I still don't think that's true. I'm still leaning towards the Nameless Star being the girl in the Verum Rex trailer. It's unknown if Strelitzia also crossed through the final world to arrive in Quadratum like Sora did. I think it's a pretty safe bet since they both effectively died or gave up their bodies in non-conventional ways. The final world and Quadratum are obviously linked in some significant way if the endings of Remind and Melody of Memory are anything to go by. Shrelly reveals to Sora that he's been asleep for 7 days, of course it's the arc number 7, and informs him that he's in a place called Quadratum. So Sora's had a hell of a time, he used the power of waking to save Kairi, woke up in nighttime final world, fought Yozora, which, mind you, seemed to take place in a simulation of Quadratum, not the actual place, either won or lost the fight, and then woke up 7 days later in the actual Quadratum, now looking significantly different. Assuming there's no timeline wonkiness, that is. Strelitzia calls Quadratum a world of life, but for people like her and Sora, more of an afterlife or afterworld. Again, as we already suspected, Quadratum seems a lot like our real world, with normally dressed people walking around or driving in their normal cars, taking pictures on their normal cell phones, etc., etc. All the while, the aforementioned pureblood heartless motherfucker is spawning in with a body most immediately similar to Darkseid, but a head that seems to take inspiration from both the Invisible Heartless and the Dark Figure, aka Ansem slash Terranort's Guardian. Given that the people of Quadratum seem pretty shocked, like more shocked than they might be if they had seen something like this a handful of times before, it's possible that Sora's appearance here has drawn the Heartless to Quadratum as well. Like, I get the impression that this is a first for these citizens. Sora charges forward, notably still armed with the Kingdom Key, and we get some gameplay, folks. Well, sort of, right? I mean, there's like two possibilities here. There's the possibility that portions of this are like early development things akin to Sora versus the Demon Tide in Twilight Town, or there's gonna be more scripted and more automated cinematic combat moments in KH4. Could potentially be both. But like this parkour shit leading up to and including the whip grab, it seems almost too smooth and clean for it to be actual gameplay. Speaking of though, the fucking whip grab, I mean Lingering Will, eat your heart out. Again, given that there's like no reticle or anything to aim with here, I think you can pretty solidly consider this part scripted, but I have no doubt that there'll be some sort of airstep-esque mechanic with the whip. Sora continues to wall run up a skyscraper and through a floating detached piece of building, as pointed out by KeyCast on Twitter, very reminiscent of a Final Fantasy VS 13 trailer, a scrapped Nomura project for those of you who are unaware. For those of you who are, yeah, I would anticipate a lot of FF vs. 13 wish fulfillment for Nomura with this game, which we've all sort of been expecting for a while, especially when introduced to the Yozora of it all. Next, in a sequence reminiscent of the Rock Titan fight while aboard the Big Thunder Mountain train in KH3, Sora counters a big punch from Mr. Motherfucker by activating what looks to be something similar to a form change, specifically the favorite deputy drill punch in KH3. At least in appearance. In function, it actually launches from Sora's Keyblade as a projectile and explodes on impact. Note that Sora is doing all of this with just the Kingdom Key. This could, again, be early dev cycle weirdness or actual proof that Sora is now able to do more when in his base form and with his most basic keychain. I should also note, people have figured out that the fourth option on the command menu here translates to something like build. Before any Fortnite memes crop up, it's entirely possible this could mean something else in English, like form or something similar to that. As Sora continues to fight Mr. Motherfucker, the voiceover from earlier picks back up, and we pan upwards to see what we can assume to be the Master of Masters on the right and another hooded figure on the left. I think it's almost certainly either Zigbar, aka Lushu, or Luxord, aka Luxord. I could be imagining things, but Zigbar's model seems more similar, like he's got the skinnier arms and waist, but Luxord also has a history of being connected with Quadratum given his supposed appearance as the driver in the victory ending of the Limit Cut episode. You would think a bigger deal would be made out of Lushu reuniting with the Master, but then also, why would Luxord and the Mom even be hanging out? And then we get the title drop, just straight up KH fucking 4, I still can't believe that. And unironically, I think I'm most excited about what happens next. We have Goofy and Donald walking in the dark with the latter using his staff as like a flashlight torch thing because sure, why not? They're looking for somebody to help them and behind them appears a blue flame startling them. The voice near the flame asks where they're going before erupting into red flames and it's Hades, right? I mean, it makes sense and people have already compared the voices on this one so it seems to be the case and I'm so excited about the possibilities with this. For the record, I don't anticipate that we're actually getting a playable Olympus again, especially since this seems just like a D&G side quest thing. But if Donald and Goofy and everyone else in the Realm of Light are trying to figure out what happened to Sora, if they think he's potentially just straight up dead, it seems like they're maybe going to be exploring any of the different avenues associated with death and the afterlife, both old and new. So cue them investigating in the underworld, maybe Davy Jones' locker in the Caribbean, maybe bring in new properties that deal with the afterlife, like Soul or Coco. There's even possibilities for integration there with Moana. Like, there's so much that can be done. Maybe some unplayable, just cutscene-based stuff like what I'm assuming this underworld trip will be, and maybe playable worlds with non-Sora characters in new properties. I mean, fuck, what if Sora ends up going to live-action properties, including remake versions of Disney movies, while people on the other side explore the traditional animated canon? I'm not, like, wild about the live-action stuff, but it seems like it could be headed that way, especially given the potential Endor factor. If you've seen like any handful of videos on my channel, you know how much I appreciate some solid Disney integration with the KH plot, so the possibilities here have me really hopeful that they can do some meaningful tie-ins with this premise. I'm also low-key hoping that they're actually looking for Orin in the underworld and Hades just happens to interrupt them. I mean, a guy can dream. It would obviously be amazing to get Final Fantasy stuff back in the mix in a more substantial way than what we had in Remind. And for the record, I'm still not sold that we'll only be playing as Sora in Quadratum. Like, mark my words on there being playable Disney worlds, I could see a side or like a stepping stone game maybe pulling that off, but not something called Kingdom Hearts 4. I don't know if Quadratum is like an overworld or just one portion of Sora's story, but I fully expect that he'll somehow wind up in Disney environments, live action or not. And if not that, then we'll certainly see other playable heroes on the other side going to playable Disney worlds. Anyway, what's going on with Riku and Kairi? Where's Yozora? The Foretellers, the other trios? There's still so much left and I'm just really excited for all of it. In terms of like IRL details, I'm sort of anticipating that this could potentially be a PS5 exclusive or at least not likely to release on PS4, mostly just a gut feeling. Also, I know it's easy to like meme about how this game is gonna take 13 years to come out, but given that there's less stuff like the Versus 13 drama getting in the way and the knowledge that the long wait period soured a lot of people on KH3, I am optimistically expecting this game to have a relatively normal length pre-release cycle. I'm sort of thinking early 2024, maybe late 2023. I'm kind of anticipating it to be a 5-year anniversary of KH3 sort of thing, which, yeah, time is flying. All of this being said, I really encourage you to temper expectations and maybe learn from the sins of our past when it comes to pre-release hype. As I've said many times, I'm really excited for the future of the series, but if I learned anything from 2018, it's that people will really lose themselves in the speculation. I feel pretty confident in this game already, and if the wait is indeed not as long, I think it's already off to a better start than KH3 was in terms of reception. But just like, hype responsibly, that's all I'm saying. Don't take everything as gospel, even from me. I don't know what I'm talking about. I'm just a guy who's making videos on the internet. Don't let people extrapolate a mile out of an inch and then sell it as guaranteed. I promise you will thank me for it in a couple of years. Low expectations have never once let me down. I recommend maybe picking up a hobby, getting into a TV show or book series to take your mind off of this for like the next 2% of your life. Yes, the Kingdom Hearts content creator is begging you to not fall victim to terminal KH brain rot. Well, I think that's all I got for now. I'm just really excited to read everyone's thoughts and shoot the shit and laugh over everyone losing their minds about potential Star Wars stuff in Kingdom Hearts. Listen, Unreality is a game changer. I would brace yourself for the possibility. And that goes for Marvel too, by the way. Okay, have fun. Thank you so much for watching.